So I'm going to tell about error estimators for DFT. So we are all aware of the numerical challenges in DFT. So how to simulate very large systems with high accuracy, how to deal with metallic and heterogeneous systems. And a relatively new challenge is to build huge databases for material design. And this particular one contains more than 200 million single point DFT calculations. And of course, to build these databases, but also to solve these problems, it would be highly desirable to have fast, reliable black box algorithms and with error estimators. So that would be the purpose of my talk. Okay, so in electronic structure calculation, we are in the following paradigm. So we have an excellent reference model, namely the n-body Schrodinger equation, but it's too complicated, so we have to approximate it using, for instance, DFT. But then DFT is a complicated model with it's a nonlinear it's a set of nonlinear partial differential equations, and so it has to be discretized. And once you have a discretized problem, you have to solve the discretized Concham equations, which are nonlinear. So you need algorithms with stopping criteria. And then you have to implement that on a computer, so select data structures, and then implement and run the code. And so in the end, instead of having the exact value of the quantity of interest you would like to compute, you have an approximation of it, which depends on the choices you made along the way. And the error analysis consists in estimating the error between this and this. Okay, and so the total error is the sum of all these components. And this can be useful, for instance, to provide error estimators and to complement the numerical results that you have with error bars, as experimental physicists and chemists do. And the second goal is to optimize dynamically the computational resources. So for instance, if you make a huge error here, maybe it's not worth using a very tight stopping criteria. Okay, and you would like to dynamically select the numerical parameters. Okay, and for instance, do the first iteration of the SCF cycle in a small basis, then refine and all that automatically. Okay, and this is why error analysis can be useful. So this is a kind of error bars that we can obtain on a simple model. So this Venn diagram has been obtained with a non-self-consistent LDI model with GTH pseudo-potentials. So here, these error bars account for the discretization error. So in this case, it was the plane wave cutoff. The algorithmic error, so these are the thresholds that we have used to stop the SF iterations, and also the floating point arithmetics. And let me emphasize that these are not statistical error bars, okay? Here, they are fully guaranteed. We are 100% sure that the exact result for this model lies in the error bars, okay? Okay, but so that's for a simple model. And the purpose, oh, okay, yeah, let me mention that this numerical results and all the results I will present today have been obtained with DFTK package. So this is a plane wave DFT package in Julia, which is one of the outcome of the ERC project we have with Laura, Yvon Amadé, and Jean-Philippe Piquemal. So the main developers of this code are Michael Herbst and Antoine Levitt, who used to be at École des Ponts, and who are now, so Michael at EPFL and Antoine at Paris-Saclay. And which is nice that it is a Julia code, so you can you can use all the Julia ecosystem, so like work with arbitrary precision very easily, use automatic differentiation and interval arithmetic. And it's a very small code, so 7K lines of code, okay? And but still, you can do DFT calculations with 1,000 electrons. So the goal is not to compete with the codes we have seen yesterday, but just to have a very simple code to do methodological developments. Okay, So today I will talk about practical error bounds on interatomic forces in CONCHAM DFT. So this is a joint work with Geneviève Dusson, Gaspard Kamelin, and Antoine Levitt. And in the second part, on the computation of response properties for metals. So here's a work with Michael Herbst, Gaspard Kamelin, Antoine Levitt, and Ben Stamm. And before that, I will recall the geometrical structure of the CONCHAM model. Okay, so we consider here a periodic CONCHAM model, meaning, well, I work in a periodic supercell. Okay, so this is, mathematically, this is a kind of torus, okay? Or let's say a cube with periodic boundary conditions. We put M ionic cores in the cell. And the positions are denoted by capital X. So capital Xj is the position of the ion number J. And we also put n valence electron pairs of electrons with, in a spin polarized state. And then the continuous formulation of the CONCHAM model is as follows. So we have to minimize the CONCHAM energy functional, which depends parametrically on the atomic positions and on the CONCHAM orbitals. So the set of CONCHAM orbitals is an n-tuple of n, capital N functions of the Sobolev space H1 with periodic boundary conditions, satisfying this L2 orthogonality, orthonormality constraints. And as you know, so the CONCHAM energy functional is composed of several terms, so kinetic energy, the interaction with ions. You can have a non-local term, but it doesn't matter. And the R3 exchange correlation potential, which is a function of rho. And an important point is that only this term depends on the atomic positions. Okay, so as we work in a periodic domain, it's quite natural to discretize this model using plane wave basis sets. So we use Fourier modes for that, which are labeled by points of the reciprocal lattice. And we define an approximation space as the span of all Fourier modes with wave vectors satisfying this assumption, where ici is energy cutoff. So this means that the kinetic energy of the eigenmodes of the Fourier modes that we select in our basis is lower than the energy cutoff ici. Okay, so in the orbital formulation of the discretized CONCHAM model, we expand the CONCHAM orbitals in the Fourier mode basis. And when we do that, if we take into account these constraints, we obtain that the minimization set is a so-called Stifel manifold. So it's the set of tall and skinny matrices. So NC is the dimension of the approximation space, N is the number of electron pairs, and these matrices has to satisfy these orthogonality conditions. The drawback of this formulation is that there is a gauge invariance, that is that C and UC, where U is any unitary matrix, have the same energy. So to fix that, we can work with a density matrix formulation, which is very interesting to do mathematical and numerical analysis, but also which is useful in some linear scaling methods, as David mentioned it yesterday. And so in this case, the new variable is P, which is related to this description by CC star. So P is an orthogonal projector on the vector space spanned by the columns of C here. And now the new minimization set is a Grassmann manifold, that is a set of Hermitian matrix, which are idempotent, and which whose trace is n, the number of electron pairs. So to analyze mathematically the discrete CONCHAM model, it's interesting to endow the Grassmann manifold with a metric. So to do that, we use the Riemannian metric induced by the Frobenius inner product. So the Frobenius inner product is just that, okay? We have the Frobenius inner product of two square matrices of same dimension, it's just that, okay? And with this inner product, we induce a Riemannian metric on the Grassmann manifold. And so let me point out that here I will use two approximation spaces. So the first one is the one in which I will do the calculation. I will this will be my approximation space. And then I will use a bigger space in which I will estimate the error that I will do on the density or on the forces. Okay. So if I want, for instance, to study the convergence of numerical analysis in the calculation space, as we did in this paper where we compared the direct minimization and self-consistent iteration approaches, then we work with this manifold with the energy cutoff equal to the energy cutoff of the calculation. Okay. On the other hand, if I want to derive error bounds on the energy, then I will consider this manifold with an energy cutoff equal to the reference energy. Okay. And when I do the calculation, I will obtain, as I do the calculation here, I will obtain an approximation of the minimum in this space. Okay, so I have two manifolds, a small one in which I will do the calculation, and a large one, which contains the small one, in which I will evaluate the error. Okay. So the tangent space to this manifold, to the Grassmann manifold, is well known. It's given by this formula. And more importantly for us, the projection, the orthogonal projection on this tangent space is given by this simple formula using a double commutator involving P. Okay, so geometrically, I have so my manifold M like that. Okay, I'm somewhere at P. I have a tangent space here. So this is TPM. Okay, and the orthogonal projector is so let's say that I have a vector here. The orthogonal projector is this. So this orthogonal projector is called a super operator in physics sometimes because it is a linear operator on the set of operators. Okay, so P is a density matrix. Okay, so it's an operator, and this is a linear operator on the space of linear operators. So in physics, sometimes people call that a super operator. Anyway. So now I want to minimize the Concham energy on this manifold, it's a curve manifold. So to do that, I noticed that the Concham energy can be defined not only on the manifold, but on an open neighborhood of this manifold. So this is the extension of the Concham energy to the whole space, eh? And I denote, so curly E is the Concham energy on the whole space. And capital E is the Concham energy functional restricted to the manifold. Okay. So to do the analysis, I need two quantities. So the first one is the gradient of this functional seen as a functional defined on the manifold. So this is simply given by the projection of the gradient of curly E onto the manifold. Okay, so geometrically, this is the gradient of E at P, and this is the gradient M of E at P. Okay? So that's a first order condition, if you want. And now I go to second order, so the Hessian of E on the manifold is composed of two terms. So again, this is a super operator. This is a linear operator on the tangent space to the manifold. And this Hessian is composed of two terms. So this one is simply the Hessian of curly E projected onto the manifold. And these terms here comes from the curvature of the manifold. Okay. So if you were in the flat space, I would just have this one. But as I am in a curve manifold, I also have a second term, which is this one. Okay. So now I can proceed to the definition of practical error bound for interatomic forces. So there have been quite a lot of works on error bounds on energy and density. So these are just a few references. So some of them, some of the people in the audience contributed, like Reinhold and Lin. And in this work, I will consider error bounds on properties. Okay, so in particular on interatomic forces, but this can be extended to other properties. And the specificity is that now it's not variational. Okay. So let me recall how to compute interatomic forces. So I'm still working on this manifold. So I want to make error estimators. So I use the big manifold, the one defined with the reference energy cutoff. And so this is the discrete energy functional, kinetic energy, R3 exchange correlation, and the interaction with ionic cores. And to get the interatomic forces, I need to solve the Kohn-Sham problem for the given interatomic, the given atomic configuration. And then I can compute the forces using Hellman-Feynman theorem by just taking the trace of the derivative of the potential with respect to the atomic positions. Okay, so this is very interesting. Hellman-Feynman allows us to compute the derivative of the energy without computing the derivative of the state. Okay. So now let me focus on just one component of the forces, just to simplify the notation. So I consider the force on the nucleus number J, okay, in the alpha direction. Okay, so alpha component of the force on the J-th atom. Okay, and I fix the nuclear configuration. Then I introduce E of P, which is the Kohn-Sham energy for this particular atomic configuration. F of P is the observable, which gives us the force if for given density matrix P. And what I want to compute is first to solve the Kohn-Sham problem to get the ground state density matrix, and then to compute the force as F applied to the ground state density matrix. Okay. So we know that we know the first order optimality of for associated with this problem is simply that the gradient of E on the manifold at P star is equal to zero, and therefore there is a natural residual for this problem, which is simply the gradient of E on the manifold at P, and this is given by the double commutator, this double commutator involving the state P and H of P, which is nothing but the Kohn-Sham Hamiltonian. Okay. Okay, and the Kohn-Sham Hamiltonian is the sum of the kinetic energy operator, the potential energy, the potential generated by the nuclei, and the gradient of the R3 exchange correlation energy. So the general principle is following. So we have a smooth Riemannian manifold, the set of admissible states. We have a smooth function, which is the residual, which vanishes if I have reached the ground state. And then I have a smooth function corresponding to the observable. And I need to solve the Kohn-Sham equation, that is to solve the equation R of P equals zero. And then with the solution to this equation, just compute the quantity of interest. Okay, and so if, and this is a big if I am in the linear regime, then I can linearize this equation, okay? So I want to solve R of P star equals zero, but P star is P plus, this is just Newton, okay? P minus P. Okay, and if I'm in the linear regime, this is R of P plus, so this is almost equal to the derivative of R applied to P star minus P, from which I find this relation. Okay, and likewise, the error on the force in the linear regime is given by this formula. So I take the gradient of M on the manifold, evaluate it at P, and I applied it to this quantity. Okay. So now I have two practical questions are rising. The first one, so if assume that P is the density matrix of the Kohn-Sham ground state computed in the calculation space, okay, which is much smaller than the space in which I'm going to evaluate the error. Okay. So are we in the linear regime? Okay. And the second question is if I am in the linear regime, how can I efficiently compute this? Okay, because I don't want to compute that. Okay, because this is again, this is a super operator. This is a linear. The equation r prime of p q equal r of p that I have to solve to get r prime p minus 1 r of p. Okay, this is an equation, a linear equation, but on the set of operators. Okay, so I don't want to solve it. Oops. So is it clear so far? No question? Okay, good. So the first question, are we in the linear regime in practice? The answer is yes. In fact, at least for plane wave calculation with nice pseudo potential, and it was quite surprising. In fact, so to test if I am in the linear regime, what I do is that I compute, for instance, the energy, the ground state density, and the interatomic force by replacing p, okay, which is the result of the calculation in the calculation space. With p plus that, okay. So or minus, yeah, r prime p minus 1 r of p. Okay, so I use a small enough system to be able to do the calculation. Okay, and with this small enough system, you can see that you are doing much better if you replace p with this quantity. Okay, so this means that you are in the linear regime. It's a good way to test if you are in the linear regime, a practical way to test if you are in the linear regime. Okay, and you can see that you gain several orders of magnitude, okay, which shows that you are in the linear regime, even with very small energy cutoff. Okay, that was 5R3 here. Okay, even with very small energy cutoff, we are in the linear regime, for at least for this GTH pseudo potential.
Is this the right calculation to do that replacement? Could this be
well for this system? No, but of course, if you have a very big system, you cannot afford to do it. Okay, so it was just a test to see on a simple system. But I mean, if you are in the linear regime for this system, very likely you are in the linear regime for big systems. Okay, yes.
So you make some distinction here between SCF and direct minimization.
Yes.
But in some sense, it's the same. It just depends on how you choose your.
Well, numerically, it's not the same. The numerical, but
it's just not well defined. What's one type or the other? I think they can mix up in the same thing.
Yeah, yeah, no, yeah.
Depending
yeah.
on how you choose the way you do the mixing.
Yes, right. I mean, So we have a paper about that with Antoine Levit and Gaspard Kemmler, but it's not this one. But we can talk after if you want.
No, it's just language-wise what you choose to call.
All right, I see.
To,
okay.
And I think that's in the community that's kind of floating.
Yeah, because you can mix the two approaches basically. So there is a natural fixed point method, a natural minimization method, direct minimization method, and then you can build. More efficient method by mixing the two approaches, so to say. Okay, but the simple SCF approach is the one computer and so on, and the simple energy direct energy minimization is I don't know the fixed point gradient on the manifold. Okay, so yeah. But yeah, you're right. Okay, so now that we are on safe ground, so we know that we are in the linear regime. Let's compute approximations of this guy. So we know that, so this is absolutely not computable because we would need a P star, the exact solution that we don't know. This is in principle computable, but too expensive. Okay, this is computable because we know P. Okay, so we could do the calculation, but it's too expensive, so we won't do it. And the thing is that it's possible to approximate this quantity by a quantity which is computable and cheap. And so this super operator is very, very easy, simple. So you can indeed apply it to the residual. And we have obtained this operator, we have deduced it from a mathematical analysis. And we have proved in the asymptotic regime that these three quantities are in fact equivalent in the asymptotic regime where the energy cutoffs go to infinity. So to get this operator, to apply this operator, you have to do the following. So P is an orthogonal projector on the Concham orbitals. So the Concham orbitals have been computed on the calculation space by solving this equation. So that's the Concham equation projected on the calculation space. So to say, then any variation of the density matrix as this form, just obtained by diagonalizing this, by differentiating this quantity. So any vector of the tangent space is of this form, and you can impose that the component of this, the vector xi, are orthogonal to all the components of the vector phi. So this is a gauge choice, and if you adopt this gauge choice, you can represent the residual by n vectors. So it should be n, not nl. Okay, so by n vectors, and these vectors are simply obtained by projecting this quantity onto the orthogonal to P. Okay, so this can, this is not a difficult calculation. And then to this operator, MP, it simply consists to in applying to these vectors, okay? So that actually, yeah, to applying to this vector, this operator, so negative Laplace minus Ti, Ti is the kinetic energy of this vector that you have here, okay? And in a Fourier basis, in plane wave basis, this operator is diagonal, and so it's very easy to apply it, okay? And so we have a good way to estimate the error on the density matrix at a very reasonable cost. So now, let's say, okay, now we have to compute the forces. We know that we are in the linear regime, so we know that this equality almost holds. And as we have a very good approximation of this guy by something that we can actually compute, let's just plug it, replace this by that, okay? That's reasonable. That's reasonable, but that fails. This is completely wrong, okay? And why? So why does that fail? It fails because these two vectors are almost orthogonal, okay? And so we are in a situation where, so the calculation, so let's put it here. So we have a, oh no. So we have a very good, we have a, so we know that to compute the error on the forces, we have to project, to compute the inner product of this vector. So that's a gradient of at P, and this vector. But this vector is almost orthogonal. And so if you replace it by something which is close, but okay, like that, for instance, so this is P, MP minus 1 R of P. Okay, so these two vectors are close, but for instance, if you replace this one by this one, you get even the sign is wrong. Okay, so this is a problem. Okay, and to show that these vectors are almost orthogonal, you can consider their Fourier coefficients, and you can see that so this is the Fourier coefficients of the error on the density matrix. This is the approximation we make, and you can see that the error in energy norm on the density matrix is localized on the highly oscillating, on the high energy Fourier modes, okay? And so we are able to approximate these high energy Fourier modes quite accurately using this, this approximation. On the other hand, as we have to compute the inner product of this and this, you see that the most important components of this vector lay on the low energy modes. Okay, and so if you don't take this into account, then you, the approximation is very bad. Okay, and so what we have done is to find a better way to approximate this, and you can do that with a Schur complement approach. So the idea, once you have identified the problem, the solution is quite easy, okay? And so what you do is that you split So you have to solve this equation. Okay, this in the tangent space of the manifold at point P. So you know that any vector can be decomposed as follows, and then you decompose each vector psi I as the component in the calculation space, which is small, and the calculation on the orthogonal to the calculation space, which is large. The Q here solves this equation. And so what you can do, so Q1 is small but has a large impact on the error on atomic forces, as we saw. This one is large but has a small impact. And so what we do is that we replace this operator by this operator, which does a very good job in the high frequency mode, and we just put zero here, and it works well. So we have to compute the new Q. We have to solve a linear problem, but in the small space, which is doable. And when you do that, we obtain a good approximation of the forces. Okay. So this is in red orange here. This is an error on the forces if you don't do anything. This is in blue. That's the error on the forces if you use the exact error on the density matrices. And in green, this is our method. So we have something in between. So we gain typically one order of magnitude on the accuracy of the forces. And so this means that we have a very good estimate on the error on the forces, okay? Because if we are able to improve the result by one order of magnitude, it means that our evaluation of the error is very good, okay? So, okay, all right. Okay, so, any question on this part? No? So let me move to the second part. Okay. So this is about. I'm going fast, no? Yeah. How much time do I have?
You have 15 minutes left in the
good.
Section, 15 minutes. A few minutes after that for questions.
All right. No, so it should be all right then. Okay. So let me move to the computation of response properties for metals. So in this case, we are focusing on the case of a linear Schrodinger-like equation to compute the kinote for those who know this object. For those who don't know, so we have a linear Schrodinger operator. We perturb it a little bit with a perturbation on the potential. And then, so this is a ground state density for this Hamiltonian. And we expand the ground state density on this for this Hamiltonian as rho plus something which is linear in the perturbation and a small term. And the kinote is the operator, again the super operator. No, here it's more an operator acting which transforms the perturbation on the potential to the modification to the density. Okay, so it's a this operator kinote is called sometimes the non-interacting density response function, or the independent particle susceptibility, or sometimes the irreducible polarizability. Okay, and the goal is to compute apply kinote to delta V in the case of metallic systems. Okay, so first we so let me explain the structure of kinote. So we diagonalize the Hamiltonian in an orthonormal basis. We rank the eigenvalues in a non-decreasing order. The ground state density is obtained by this formula, where Fn are the occupation numbers obtained from the energy and the Fermi level. Using the Fermi-Dirac function. So with a factor 2 because we are dealing with spin and polarized systems. And at zero temperature, the Fermi-Dirac function converges to this step function, while at a positive temperature it has this shape. And the Fermi level, epsilon f, is the unique, because for positive temperature it is unique, the unique real number such that the integral of the density, where the density is defined by this formula, is equal exactly to the number of electrons you have in your system. Okay, so I just introduced this notation. F prime n will be 1 over t, the derivative of f evaluated at this point. And sometimes in formula, I will write it like that. Because... Okay, so the linear response is, so if you open a physics textbook, the linear response operator is usually given in terms of the sum over state formula. So let me go through it. So in the sum over state formula, you compute delta rho by a double sum over all the states of the Hamiltonian, of the eigenvectors of the Hamiltonian. The delta V here, delta V and M are just delta V sandwiched between the eigenvectors of the Hamiltonian. This is the difference of the occupation numbers of the states M, N and M, and divided by the energy of these states. So this is non-singular because the difference between these two go to zero, this converges to the derivative of F evaluated at epsilon N. And delta epsilon F also has a unique value because you want this function to integrate to zero. And the delta epsilon F is given by this form. Okay. So this is a nice formula that you find in any textbook, but it is basically impractical for numerical purposes because you have a double sum over all the states. Okay. So fortunately, when you consider a Schrodinger light operator, it is known in 3D that the epsilon n grow as n to the 2/3 using the Weyl formula. And so at some point, the Fermi-Dirac function applied to this quantity is completely negligible, except in some applications such as warm dense matter, where you have really a huge number of non-negligibly occupied states. But for usual calculation, the number of number of states which are significantly occupied is not much larger than the number of electrons in the system. Okay. And so this allows us to simplify a little bit the sum over state formula by just making one of the double sum finite. Okay, so this is now a finite sum, and n is not too large, but still we have another infinite sum. So to fix that, we have to use the so-called Sternheimer equation. So let me present that. So another way to compute delta rho is just to differentiate this formula, okay, like that. But the point is that now the delta phi n and the delta fn are not unique because of the gauge invariance I was mentioning earlier. Okay. So the delta phi n can be projected on the space. So P now is a space spanned by the eigenvectors which are partially or fully occupied. Okay, so I take all the so n epsilon epsilon capital N is somewhere around here. Okay, so I take all the eigenvectors, all the states which are almost completely occupied or partially occupied, and then I put a cutoff here. At, I don't know, 10 to the minus 10, if you want. Okay. Decays exponentially, so I can truncate that. Okay, so this is, so P is an orthogonal projector on the occupied states, and I split delta phi n in two parts, one in the in-plane and out-of-plane components. Then we write fn delta phi n as follows. So this part is correspond to this, and this one to that. And this is just a matrix, and I can rewrite delta rho using this matrix and using the components of delta phi n on the orthogonal space. Now I can compare the two formulas. So this one, which is a sum over state formula, truncated using the fact that some states are not occupied, and the formula I just obtained. And if I identify these two expressions, we find that gamma mn and the delta fn must satisfy this system of equations, okay, which is underdetermined. And so I need to make a gate choice at some point. And the delta phi nq satisfy the well-known Sternheimer equations, which are written as follows. Okay, so the problem is that, so here we have a small problem that we have to fix the gate, and here we have a more serious problem is that this equation can be ill-conditioned. So let me first talk about the gate choice. We have to satisfy these constraints. So we have to choose the gamma mn and the delta fn to satisfy this constraint. So this is the diagonal part of the matrix gamma nn. So we can just choose this. Okay, so it's very convenient, very simple, it works well. For the off-diagonal terms, there are several choices. One apparently natural way, but it's a very bad idea, is to maintain the orthogonality of the vectors. Okay, so I have I take before perturbating the Concham eigenvectors are orthonormal. Okay, and I could choose the gamma mn to maintain the orthonormality. Okay, but you shouldn't do that. Okay, it's very bad. So this is what you get if you impose these constraints, but you should not do that, okay? Because if you do that, these quantities may blow up and then ruin the simulation. So people realize that and design some gate choices, okay? This is the one used in Abinit, the one in Quantum Espresso. And we just try to minimize the problem is that we don't want this quantity to blow up. So what we do is that we minimize the square of the modulus of this quantity under the constraint that this satisfies this equation. And if you do that, you obtain a very simple expression for the gamma mn. Okay, there is another one by weighting that. Okay, so we have two simple gauges that we use in our code DFTK, but it turns out that you can do any choice except the orthogonal one, and they work equally well. Okay, so this is not a serious issue. Okay. Let me now focus on the most interesting question: is that how to solve the Sternheimer Sternheimer equation. Okay, so what we have at hand is n fully converge orthonormal eigenmodes that we use to build the Concham density matrix and the Concham density. And we also have extra partially converge eigenvectors that are obtained by the Krylov method. Okay, in Krylov, you use more vectors than you need. Okay, so you have extra vectors which are not fully converged, but maybe you can do something with them. So this is the idea. So we can assume without loss of generality that the fully converged eigenvectors and these extra eigenvectors are an orthonormal family. We can use Laura's method to orthogonalize them. We can also assume that these vectors, just for simplicity, that these vectors are... that this matrix is diagonal, okay? And we know, because that's a result of Krylov method, that if you iterate, these vectors will converge to the exact eigenvectors. Okay. And so the idea is to use these extra approximate eigenvectors to improve the computation of the response properties. So to do that, we have to solve an equation on Q, okay? On this space. So this vector belongs to the space corresponding to this part of the spectrum. And we split it in two parts. So this space corresponds to that. This is the extra eigenvectors, not perfectly converged, but the extra approximate eigenvectors that we have. We use them to construct an approximation space. And then again, we use the Schur complement method. Here, we have a Hill condition method because epsilon n for n equal capital N may be very close to epsilon n plus 1. Okay? So here, we know that this method is potentially very Hill condition, and for metals, it will be Hill condition, okay, in general. But, well, not necessarily, but okay, it may be Hill condition. But in any case, it's small. Okay? And this one, as we create a gap in the spectrum, because the largest of this guy is this one, epsilon n, and r starts there. So we have created a big gap, and so therefore, this matrix is coercive, large, but well-conditioned. Okay? And so we solve this system by inverting this matrix, which is Hill condition Boltzmann, so you can invert it. You plug it in this formula to get the alpha n, and then you solve this well-conditioned problem to get this part of the vectors. Okay, and so if we use that, so it works reasonably well. So we gain factor 2 in the number of iterations. Okay, so it's time to conclude. Okay, so in the first part of the talk, I discuss error bounds for DFT. So I shown you in the introductory part of the talk that it's possible to obtain guaranteed, fully guaranteed, optimal, and cheap error bounds on the ground state and density for linear Schrödinger operators. So that was the band diagram I shown you with the error bars. For DFT, we are not. It's very difficult to obtain guaranteed error bars. And if we do, they are not cheap. But we can get practical error bars, which are optimal and cheap, reasonably cheap, on the ground state energy and density of DFT. Okay? And regarding forces, it's possible to obtain practical and quite accurate and not too expensive error bounds for forces. Okay. Regarding response properties, we have seen that it is easy for insulators, it's harder for metals. We have to select a gate choice. So here, I mean, the existing methods were good, okay? We just clarified this point and proposed a new, very simple gauge. And then the spelling is correct. And then the Sternheimer equation is Hill condition, but using Schur complement method, it's possible to improve the numerical methods to solve these equations. Okay, so thank you for your attention.